how did these books get in the New Testament? Or how did these books get to be the New Testament? How do they come together? And how do they get to be seen as Scripture? Whether or not you and I believe these writings are Scripture and writings from God does not matter at this point. I do think that, but the historical process is the same, whether one looks at it from inside the church or outside the church. The main thing I want to say to you about how these 27 writings come together and how they come to be viewed as Scripture is that it's a process. It did not happen at the beginning or at the end. It's a process, and most of it happens between the year 100 and 200. The New Testament documents are written in the second half of the first century, from the year 50 to the year 100, most of them between 50 and 75 probably. And the church finally landed on these 27 in a series of councils that happened around the year 400. So we have a process, a development that takes about 300 years roughly from the year 100 to the year 400. And when I say it's a process, I want particularly to take away the impact of the beginning and of the end of the process. Were these writings seen as Holy Scripture as soon as they were written? No, they were not. The writers all understood that the Hebrew Bible, what we call the Old Testament, was writing from God, but the New Testament writers did not tell their readers that their writing was on the same level as the Old Testament. And we must say this for the New Testament writers, they do have a peculiar confidence. People were amazed at the teaching of Jesus, it says in the Gospels, because he spoke with authority and not like other Gospels, not like the other experts. Some of this seems to have rubbed off on the New Testament writers. The apostolic fathers who wrote immediately after the year 100 did not have that same flavor. But when they were first received, the New Testament writings were not received by churches as if they were on a level with their treasured Old Testament. They were useful and they were important enough to hand around. Let's also take away the impact of the end of the process, the different councils around the year 400. Most of the important decisions about our New Testament were made gradually, and they were complete by the year 200, almost 200 years before the canon councils. More details on that in a moment. People with a high view of Scripture would prefer that as soon as these documents were written, they were seen by the writer and the readers as Scripture inspired by God's Spirit. That is not how it was. People with a low view of Scripture would prefer that there was no real New Testament Scripture at all until the councils with their political wrangling ruled on these things around the year 400. But it did not happen that way either. To be blunt, these writings were not seen as Scripture by the year 100, and they were long before the councils of 400. I'm going to change direction a bit, and then I'll come back to that. It was likely in some ways from the very start that there would be New Testament Scriptures. Here's why. One, the Hebrew Bible, what we call the Old Testament, was the words of God to the New Testament church from the start. By all the evidence we have, the Old Testament was Scripture from God and seen that way by Jesus himself and assumed that by his followers. Even Paul, in his letters to Gentile churches, believers in Corinth or Galatia, he quotes the Old Testament as authoritative, and he has no need to introduce or explain. All these Gentile churches, those early churches, know that it's Scripture, it's written from God to guide his people, and that's assumed. One, the early church from the start has the Hebrew Bible, what we call the Old Testament, and two, they have the words of Jesus. From the very beginning, already during his life, Jesus' words were on a level with the Old Testament. He didn't write anything. We're just talking here about what people heard and what was passed on. In several different ways, Jesus made his own words equal to the Old Testament. I'm going to give you one example. In Matthew, Jesus speaks this way. You've heard it said. Then he quoted one of the Ten Commandments. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. And then he says, but I say to you. So Jesus felt complete freedom to revise, adjust, even the Ten Commandments given by God. There are a number of examples from this in the Gospels. And there are also examples in Acts and Paul in his letters quoting Jesus with authority. But that's enough. So from the very start, We have the Old Testament, which they assume to be writing from God, and they have Jesus on the same level, the words spoken by Jesus. And so already beside the Old Testament, they have something else that counts to them just as much, and what is quoted in Acts and in the few letters that happens, the words of Jesus spoken and remembered and repeated have the same kind of authority as our Old Testament, their Hebrew Bible. And not only does the early church have the Old Testament and the words of Jesus, but they have the apostles. Jesus chose 12 men from a larger group of followers, and the understanding from the start was that they were Jesus' delegates, his messengers. So you have to picture yourself as part of a larger crowd of followers, something not unlike what's in this room right now, and you watch Jesus pick 12, and he walks, and they are, for the most part, closer to him, but you are also all followers of Jesus. Jesus sent out 70 and so on. There's a large group of men and women that follow him. But Jesus spends time with these 12. They are clearly going to be his delegates, and he goes off alone with him sometimes, and the rest of you and me are not welcome. So Jesus has authority equal to the Old Testament. Who will speak for Jesus when he's gone? Well, for this group of followers that you and I are a part of, we all know that it will be those 12. It was his own choice that the apostles would speak for him when he was gone. This does not mean that the spoken words of the apostles or the written words of the apostles immediately had the full authority of Jesus' words. It was not like that at all. The church listened to the apostles because the church needed to know what to believe and how to live. They wanted to aim themselves in the right way. They weren't asking about scripture. They wanted to be guided, and the apostles were good at that. But you can see how viewing the writings of the apostles as scripture is not a completely new possibility. In some ways, much of the foundation for a new scripture was laid already within Jesus' life. It was, in fact, about the year 200 that the new writings were seen as scripture on the same level as the Old Testament. There's no decision about this. There's no council. There's no controversy that we know about. We just read the fathers, starting with the year 100, and we read the fathers in chronological order. And by the time it comes to the year 200, they view their writings as on the same level as the Old Testament. It's scripture as the Jewish Bible. So we're going to do a little bit of a timeline here. Already before the year 100, there's some evidence that some of Paul's letters were collected together and were passed around between churches. So that's just a little, maybe in the last decade of the first century. By the year 130, every major church has the four Gospels. Okay, this is a long ways before Canon Council. By 130, every major church has the four Gospels. They don't call them Scripture, but they have Matthew and Mark and Luke and John, and there's no competition for that from any other writing. These four are the established written authority on the life of Christ by 130. By 150, every major church has Paul's 13 letters. Good authorities, some think Paul's letters were known by 130, like the Gospels, but others date it at 150, and I'm trying to be relaxed about this. So somewhere in there, but I don't know anybody who dates that later than 150. So these two collections are the two pillars of the New Testament. There's the four Gospels, and there's Paul's 13 letters, and by the year 150, every major church is reading both of those every Sunday, as well as they are reading what we call the Old Testament. So that's by 150. The four Gospels and Paul's 13 letters. I don't have that many fingers. By the year 200, two more important things have happened. So that's by 150. By the year 200, two developments. One is the four Gospels and Paul's letters are now viewed as scripture equal to the Old Testament. The second thing that happened by the year, let me go back to that a little more. They're considered scriptures, they're writings from God with equal authority to the Old Testament. Again, there's no debate we know about. There's not a discussion. There's not a description of theology or how they came to that conclusion. It's just that everybody around the year 200 is comfortable calling this scripture, and that's assumed. That's the first thing that happens by 200. They're now seen as scripture. And the other thing is that all the other writings in our New Testament are also in circulation. Acts, Hebrews, Revelation, and the letters of James, John, Peter, and Jude. They're in circulation, but not every church is reading the same thing. And some churches read books that most of the churches did not read and did not make it into the New Testament, like the Shepherd of Hermas or the Epistle of Barnabas and stuff like that. So there's a gray area on the edge here. And the churches were not at all alarmed by this. They were not alarmed that different churches were not, that the churches were not reading all exactly the same thing. They all had enough writings in common for them to be aimed in the same direction. And when they had disagreements with each other, the difference in scripture was not causing the problem. The variation continued on for a long time until the year 400, when they decided to tidy this up. The councils were like cleaning up the kitchen and sweeping the floor after you have cooked supper and eaten it. The important stuff was all done. Now it was time to tidy up. In doctoral studies, I took a course on New Testament canon from an early father's teacher, not a New Testament teacher, and the course ignored the councils completely. We never even bothered with them because all the good stuff happened well before that. So it's a process. Don't put much emphasis on how the churches first received these writings, and don't put much emphasis on the councils at the end. If we want to know how it actually happened, the important developments took place gradually and quietly between the year 100 and 200. By then, they had all four Gospels, they had Paul's 13 letters, they had most of the rest, and they knew it was scripture equal to the Old Testament and to the words of Jesus. Thank you.